said, "Man, how do you listen to stuff? It's really scary." And I said, "You know, I know the end, right? I know how this all ends."
This is why in 2 Corinthians, Paul says that he's afraid for the Christians, because eventually there's going to come false teachers in the end times. They're going to be teaching a false gospel and a false Jesus.
That's one thing I don't understand. The book of Revelation is the only book in the Bible that promises a blessing to those who read it. So why isn't it largely being studied? You know, it's the back of the book. It's the end of the story. It's Christ's victory. Why is this book so highly ignored?
Sorry that we're late, but let's start this day off right. And we wanted to start off by telling everyone, happy birthday.
One year. No.
It's not what you think. Approximately 2,000 years ago today, the church was born. Pentecost. Today is the Feast of Shavuot. So, we got all of you guys birthday cakes.
Cupcakes. Happy birthday, church.
So, happy birthday, church.
You don't look that old.
I know. So, 2,000 years ago, the church was born. 4,000 years ago, the law was given literally to the day.
Yes.
Man, look at this. I'm getting super service up here. Fresh coffee. Thank you, sir.
You're welcome. Michael.
So, hey Jake, will you pass around everybody a cupcake?
Yeah, sure.
Michael, you want a cupcake?
No, thank you.
Okay.
Happy birthday.
It's birthday cake. Pentecost birthday. So, it was a special day. Once again, 50 days after Passover is officially the Jewish feast of Shavuot. What's crazy is that for 7 weeks of 7 days, the Jews would literally count down to the day, knowing that God was going to show up on the 50th day. It was called the counting of the weeks. So literally, they always knew to wait in expectation. So what happened after Passover, exactly 50 days to the day, Moses received the law on Mount Sinai. And so once again, these Jews celebrate Pentecost over and over again for thousands of years. And we saw it ultimately culminate with the birth of the church around 2,000 years ago at the Feast of Pentecost in Acts chapter 2. So, we are celebrating today the birthday of the church. What's kind of interesting, since we're eschatology or prophecy nerds, just so you know, there are some theologians who teach that it's possible that the rapture of the church could happen on Pentecost. Of course, we know the rapture of the church can happen on any day, and we look forward to that on any day, but there are some theologians who've made some connections as to show that the church was born on this day, and some theologians think the church will end on this day. Wouldn't that be nice if today we were celebrating and we were ultimately in the middle of a worship song brought into the presence of the Lord? Wouldn't that be great?
Amen. Yes.
So have your ears open today.
Yep.
You hear any loud trumps, just jump, get a head start.
According to you,
I'll play the Bible's extra loud for you.
Yes.
Did you mention the number 50 stands for the anointing?
You can teach that. I don't know that one.
Oh,
teach
no.
It.
In numerology.
Yeah.
Number 50 stands for the anointing.
50 is the Jubilee year, so what's the anointing?
Go ahead. The Holy Spirit.
See? Exactly, and that's when the Holy Spirit was poured out on the church.
And that's where we derive our organizational structure as being Pentecostal,
mm-hmm.
The day of Pentecost.
Yep, absolutely. So we should expect a special manifestation of the Holy Spirit today, especially when we're worshiping. Mm-hmm. What was I going to say? Oh yeah, according to Jewish tradition, Enoch was actually born on Pentecost, and according to Jewish scholars, he was also raptured on Pentecost. That's another reason why some people think the church will be raptured, because Enoch is actually a type of the church. You want to explain that real quick?
Sure. You guys remember We talked about this earlier in the class, that the flood is a picture of the final judgment period, the final tribulation period. So we said there's three types of people affected by that event. There was the people that were destroyed during the flood. There are the people that were preserved through the flood. And then there was the one body taken before the flood even started. So you have Enoch as a picture of the church, the one body that was removed before God's judgment. You have the Jews that are going to be preserved through the final judgment period, and then you have those that are destroyed in the final judgment period. You have that as a model. You know, Enoch is the model of the body that is taken out before. That would be us in the final time period. We are the body of Christ. We will be removed before the final judgment.
Amen. It's a good type, good shadow. All right, well, let's get started. We're a little bit behind. I haven't done this in a while, but I have some prophecy in the headlines that we wanted to talk about. Always fun things in the news. Isn't it interesting, this past week, human-pig hybrids for organ transplants could develop into monsters with our brains. So now science is really pushing the envelope with mixing animal and human DNA. Kind of some crazy things. It's the Blaze report, scientists create part man, part pig embryos to try to grow human organs in pigs. And once again, isn't it just interesting times that we live in? Imagine, what do you think things like this does? What do you think the creator of the universe thinks when man is down here manipulating DNA? I wanted to read a couple things here. Concern has already surfaced that playing God in this way could open the door to pigs developing with human intelligence and too much like us. There are fears that mixing pig and human genes in this way could see the animals develop looking like animals but with human brains or boosted intelligence. This is a slippery slope that scientists are playing on. And just so you guys know, if this is now being released in the news, science is well advanced as to what is actually going on behind the scenes. Okay, so it's just stuff to keep on your radar. Amid concerns that the human pig chimeric embryos could develop too much like us, the inch-long embryos are only being allowed to develop inside the sows for 28 days before the pregnancies are terminated and the tissue removed for analysis. So don't worry, they're being ethical through all this, okay? They have our best interests at hand. So once again, we live in very interesting times. And when I'm reading the news, I look at just the converging of all these different things, the technology, the economy, just all these different things. Everything's kind of coming to a head here, pointing to the return of Jesus. Transgender athlete vies for high school state track championship and faces controversy. I had to tell you guys this one because I was a track guy, and this story really kind of struck me. But that girl, I believe it's the one on the far right, is actually born a boy. And she's going through the hormone therapy. She wants to be a boy, or she thinks she's a boy. Alaska has allowed her to compete in state versus other females.
She's born a boy but wants to compete against the girls.
Right.
Okay.
And just so you guys know, I watch the Olympics. I could be an Olympic woman's world record holder if I wanted to. I thought about it when I was growing up. I was like, man, if I could just be a chick, then I would dominate, you know. But I never really went through with it. But once again, do you guys see the slippery slope that we are beginning to go down here with issues like this? It's going to get very interesting as we see labels redefined, what God's rules being redefined, right? Man, woman. This is all a big deal. Finally, now is the Leonardo DiCaprio, who speaks on behalf of all of us, by the way. He is a UN messenger of peace who flies all around the world in his jumbo jets telling us to have smaller carbon footprints. Now is the time for bold, unprecedented action. It is time to ask each other, which side of history will you be on? It's just kind of it's kind of crazy when I see things like read like this. Now is the time for bold, unprecedented action. And of course, he's talking about issues with climate change. Okay, climate change, you guys are hearing this over and over again. And one of the things studying prophecy that I've really kept my eye on is this climate change agenda one of the things that's going to really bring in this one world mentality? We all need to come together and save planet Earth, right? Which once again, of course, we believe as Christians that we need to take care of the Earth. It's good stewardship. I recycle, you know, I love the Earth. But what's interesting is we are living in a very interesting time as we see things progress to they're actually going to start making changes in us lowering what's called our carbon footprint, whether it's using less gas, whether it's using less electricity at our house. We don't quite know yet, but we are living in times where we're going to see some of these changes begin to take place. So I don't know what that's going to look like yet. But when I see the words like, now is the time for bold, unprecedented action, I wonder in my head, what is bold, unprecedented action? Okay? And I also wonder, which side of history will you be on? You're seeing the rhetoric begin to really advance. Those who deny climate change are going to be looked at as people holding the earth back. Okay, and those who are on the other side, of course, he's saying, which side of history are you going to be on? You're going to be on the side that fixes Mother Earth, and you guys are going to go with the flow, and we're going to start doing all this stuff, or are you going to be with the climate deniers? Anytime you get that polarity, which once again, are you guys seeing the polarity in the world? Blacks versus whites, men versus women, feminism, all the polarity. It's just interesting to look at it all in the big picture and realize that someday, somebody is going to step into the world and have an answer to cure all of these problems. I think we're seeing a ramp up of all the problems, the polarization really coming to fruition because the world is now being prepared for an answer or a savior who is going to be false savior, false answer in the Antichrist. But as I said, we're just seeing the signs of the times right now. The stage is being set for the rapture, the return of Jesus Christ. If Jesus and us and we all pray and we say, God, give us more time down here to save more souls, the Lord tarries, he kind of slows things down. Is that possible? Absolutely. But what we're looking at right now is the stage being set. Okay? So, interesting times we live in. All right, real quick, by means of review, last week we talked about, we're still in Thyatira personal application. We finished it up. We need to be lights shining in the darkness. As the world that we live in grows darker, we need to let our lights shine. We talked about that. We need to protect ourselves from Jezebel philosophies. We kind of looked at all of those. Mystery Babylon and its relevance today. We talked briefly about Mystery Babylon and some of the things that are in pop culture that our kids are seeing on a daily basis. And we just talked about that Mystery Babylon is actually well more prevalent than we realize. So, as I said last week, that concluded Thyatira. Now, real quick, we're going to look at the big picture here. We went over this last week, so we'll just skim through. The final takeaway for Thyatira is we need to rest in Jesus, the Son of God, and his completed work. So when I do these big picture points, each one of these seven letters, it's kind of like, what is the big takeaway from this letter? And we believe the big takeaway from this letter is that we need to rest in Jesus, the Son of God, and his completed work. And don't allow false essential doctrine into your midst. Amen.
Perfect timing.
All right, so let's pray. We'll get some new material and get going.
Father, we thank you so much for everything that you've done for us and all of our blessings. And we ask that you would join us this morning and open up our hearts and lives to your word so we can use the information that you give us to be better stewards for your kingdom, and we can be a light to the world. We ask that you do this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. All right, so as always, I give you guys a little bonus material after I finish a church. This is fun stuff to me and T. Hood and Derek and other nerds. So what's interesting is we have these seven churches, okay? Ephesus, Smyrna, Pergamos, Thyatira, Sardis, Philadelphia, Laodicea. There's actually seven kingdoms of the Old Testament that run parallel to these seven churches. And Jesus also gives us seven parables in Matthew 13 that run parallel to these seven churches. And when you look at them side by side, you guys will see crazy things align. Okay, and what this does is it really edifies us as Christians because you see all these little things fall into place and you realize that God inspired his word and that all of this stuff is in his hand. It's his story. He's bringing everything to fruition. So look at Thyatira here, or the kingdoms. We saw that Ephesus corresponded with Saul. We saw that Smyrna, the persecuted church, corresponded with David. We saw Pergamos, where sin really kind of began to enter the Israelites, came with Solomon's reign. And Thyatira, this is a pretty simple one, Jezebel, and actually, if you want to get technical, it was Ahab's reign, but we know Ahab was really ruled by Jezebel, so it's kind of Jezebel's kingdom period corresponds with the church of Thyatira. And I don't think I need to go into detail with that. We spent many months talking about Jezebel, so you can see that correspondence there. This is where things get really interesting. The parables that Jesus talked about in Matthew 13. What's amazing is there's so many layers of application to these parables that Jesus gave. So many layers. So I don't want you guys to think that the layer I'm getting ready to show you is the only layer of this, but I want you guys to see that there's some very interesting things here. So the letter of Thyatira corresponds with the woman and the leaven. Isn't this interesting? Let's read the parable real quick. Matthew 13, verse 33. Another parable he spoke to them. The kingdom of heaven is like leaven, which a woman took and hid in 3 measures of meal till it was all leavened. And this is the parable that Jesus said, and this is mysterious. It's a kingdom parable. It's a mystery. But isn't it interesting that the word for leaven is the Greek word zyme? It's used 13 times in the New Testament. And if you study every time it's used in the New Testament, it's only used in a negative context. There is never a good word about leaven. And you see Jesus talk about the leaven of the Pharisees and the Sadducees over and over again. 1 Corinthians 5, your glorying is not good. Do you not know that a little leaven leavens the whole lump? Therefore purge out the old leaven that you may be a new lump, since you truly are unleavened, for indeed Christ, our Passover, was sacrificed for us. Therefore let us keep the feast not with old leaven, nor with the leaven of malice and wickedness, but with the unleavened bread of sincerity and truth. So we see leaven is a picture of sin. It's a picture of evil. It's a picture of basically sin within us. So it's interesting that we see this parable corresponding with Thyatira. This woman takes this leaven and she hides it in 3 measures of meal. Isn't this interesting? The word for hide is that Greek word there. I don't even think I'm going to attempt that one. Egrypto? Is that pretty good? Okay. It's used only 2 times in the New Testament, and it's referenced to being hidden or mingled. And when this woman mingles this leaven into this bread, the whole object becomes leavened. Isn't it interesting that we studied this time in church history and we kind of saw some of these mystery Babylonian religions enter into the church? Is it possible that this time in church history that we talked about from 600 AD to 1500 AD was this mystery Babylonian religion infiltrating the church and kind of leavening the whole lump? What's interesting is there is actually 3 branches of the visible church. You have the Roman Catholic Church, you have the Eastern Orthodox, and then you have the Protestant. Just an interesting little side note. Is that possible that this woman hiding the leaven in the 3 measures of meal, that's kind of a picture of the church now getting some of these mystery Babylonian religions infused and making the whole lump leavened? Interesting. So, once again, you guys are left to decide, does that parable coincide with Thyatira and does it fit? I believe it does. So, that's once again, that just shows you the structural integrity of the Bible. You see these types of things lay out. You see these churches lay with these kingdoms, lay with these parables, and it's just only God can orchestrate this stuff, right? Only God can orchestrate it. So, there's the Thyatira. Since we're a little bit behind, I'm going to skip rereading it in conclusion. We're done with Thyatira, so we're going to have a party here. So real quick, let's go over it. The name of the meaning of Thyatira was a perpetual or continual sacrifice. The title Jesus used was the Son of God, who has eyes like a flame of fire and his feet like brass. They did get a good report card. They had some things said that were good. They had love, service, faith, patience. Their condemnation, so what was bad with this church, is they allowed Jezebel to teach and seduce within the church. So the exhortation, so what did Jesus tell this church to do? The people who were saved, he said, just hold on until I come. Just wait, hold it out. The unsaved, he said, repent from holding Jezebel's doctrine. Get rid of that false doctrine and get saved. The promise to the overcomer is that he will rule with Jesus in the age to come, and he's promised the morning star. And finally, the closing is postscripted, which we'll talk more about that later. So, it's official. We did it. We made it through Thyatira. How long was that, Derek?
The longest letter.
Pretty much half of our classes so far were Thyatira.
We spent a long time at Thyatira. But remember, guys, that we did some other Jewish teachings in there. We talked on the rapture. We talked on some other stuff. So it's not all my fault that we're that far behind. All right, so let's go ahead and quickly jump into our new letter. If you don't have your new notes here, just we'll hook you up. But we're going to the church at Sardis now. Let me bring that up. Don't peek ahead. Okay, So we are studying Jesus' letter to the church at Sardis. Yep.
Boom.
So, what's interesting, I saw one theologian call this church the Church of the Living Dead. Okay? What's amazing is we just saw some bad stuff with Thyatira, right? And everybody thinks that I'm only picking on a certain group of the church. Like I said, don't worry. By the time we get done with all seven letters, we're going to pick on all churches. Okay? Because we all got some stuff we got to work out, right? But the Church of the Living Dead. So let's talk about this real quick by means of review. I think it's good for us to take a step back before we take a step forward, especially since we have a few noobs here. And we got some of you guys need to pay attention to this because you guys didn't see some of this when we originally taught it. So we're studying out of Revelation chapter 2 and 3. Okay? Let's go back all the way to the beginning. The revelation of Jesus Christ. This is Revelation 1 verse 1. The revelation of Jesus Christ. Notice that. This is the revelation of Jesus Christ. First of all, notice it's not plural. This isn't the revelations of Jesus Christ. This is the revelation of Jesus Christ. This entire book that we are studying is about revealing Jesus Christ. It's not about dragons. It's not about vials. It's not about demon locusts. It's not about fill in the blank that everybody commonly associates this book with. This book is associated with revealing who Jesus Christ is. Okay? So the revelation of Jesus Christ, which God gave him. Notice there that him is capital. Okay? A lot of people miss this when they're reading the book of Revelation. The revelation of Jesus Christ, which God gave him. The him there is Jesus. The Father revealed his plan to his Son, and then his Son disperses it to us through John. Okay? You guys following? God gave him to show his servants. By the way, we're his servants. Things which must shortly take place. And he sent and signified it by his angel to his servant John. By the way, he signified it. He's basically saying he's going to put this whole kind of end times in signs and symbols and pictures. Okay, signified it through the Holy Spirit. That's why when we read this book of Revelation, we see all kinds of crazy symbols like dragons and moon, the moon under the woman's feet, and so on and so forth. It's all kind of signified, okay? But what's cool is as you know your Bible, all those signs in the book of Revelation are described somewhere else in the Bible. It's explained. So a lot of people stay away from the book of Revelation because they're scared of it. But if you know your whole Bible, you can put together the pieces of the puzzle. So this was signified it by his angel.
It's treasure hunt.
Treasure hunt. It's fun. That's why I say, you see right here that at the bottom, blessed is he who reads and those who hear the words of this prophecy. Okay, you and I were blessed just because we study this book. Okay, I don't know about you guys. We've been going at it for over a year now. Think about all the places in the Bible we've already been. And we're only in the start of chapter 3. We've learned about Balaam. We've learned about Jezebel. We've learned proper doctrine. We've been all over the Bible, and we're not even in chapter 3 yet. Imagine as we get through all these symbols and stuff 10 years from now, when we finish this book, we will literally have mastered the whole Bible together. Okay? There's more than 800 allusions to the Old Testament in the book of Revelation. 800. That's why a lot of people shy away from the book of Revelation. And I'm not trying to say this to sound cocky, but they shy away from the book of Revelation because they don't know their Bible. They're scared of it because it's confusing. Okay? But if you know your Old Testament, you're going to know all these pictures and all these symbols. Okay. Let's move on. Revelation 1 verse 19. And by the way, Jesus is speaking to John here, the disciple John. Okay, the apostle John. Write the things which you have seen and the things which are and the things which will take place after this. You might, if you got your Bible, circle this. This is key to understanding the entire book of Revelation. This is the table of contents. Revelation 1 verse 19 is the content, the table of contents for the entire Bible or for the entire book of Revelation. Notice those three colors there. One, the things which you have seen. Two, the things which are. Three, the things which will take place after this. You have the table of contents right here. Let me give this to you visually just to really help you to understand. Okay, so this is kind of the layout, right? The things which you have seen. So do you guys see that little picture of Jesus right there? If you read Revelation chapter 1, John sees a vision of the resurrected Christ. That's the thing which John has seen. So he says, write down what you've seen. And John writes down a description of Jesus. That's chapter 1. Okay? Now, notice there John says, and the things which are in red. We've been living in what's known the 2,000-year church age. Okay, the church was born 2,000 years ago. We've been living in what's called the church age. Okay, these seven letters correspond to the church age. Okay, the things which are the church age. That's why we're spending so much time in these seven letters, because they're the most relevant to us today. We live in the things which are. The churches were already in existence when John wrote the book of Revelation. So the things which are these seven churches in Revelation. Okay? And finally, write the things which will take place after this. The Greek words for after this are meta tauta. I know that sounds silly to you now, but that makes all the difference in the world as we progress forward. But we believe chapters 4 through 22 happen after the church age. Okay? This is another type of what we will call the pre-tribulational rapture, meaning the church, who, by the way, is mentioned multiple times. What is it, 18 times?
Something like that.
18 times in chapters 2 and 3. Guess how many times the word church is used in chapters 4 through 22? Is it one?
At the very end. It's one, like 21, 22.
One at the very, very end. So you have all these chapters where not the ecclesia, the church, is not mentioned. Why is that? Because we believe chapters 4 through 22 is laying out what we're going to call the tribulation on earth. The 7-year period of tribulation is chapters 4 through 20. We'll be watching from heaven, okay? And I know it's going to be a sad time on earth, but we'll be having the marriage supper of the Lamb. We'll be partying in heaven. We'll be sad for those we didn't get through to down here. That's why it's important for us right now. Every one of us has a circle of influence, okay? It's important for us right now to be telling people, hey, the flood's coming. Let's get on the ark, okay? You want to get people out of here before this final 7-year period comes, where people are left with the final decision. So there's kind of the table of contents. So with that being said, let's jump right into our letter and get going to the church of Sardis. Does that all make sense to you, that table of contents? You guys see how Jesus laid that out for us? Okay. Revelation 3, verses 1 through 6. And to the angel of the church of Sardis write, these things says he who has the seven spirits of God and the seven stars. I know your works, that you have a name that you are alive, but you are dead. That's why we call this church the church of the living dead. They have a name of being alive, but they are dead. I looked up the Greek word for dead. Guess what it means? Dead. There's no tricky here. They're dead. Okay. Now we'll talk about what that means to be spiritually dead, but we'll talk about that. Be watchful and strengthen the things which remain that are ready to die, for I have not found your works perfect before God. Remember, therefore, how you have received and heard. Hold fast and repent. 5 of these 7 churches are told to repent, just so you know. Repent means a complete change of your mind. Okay, change your mind and start following me differently. Okay, 5 out of these 7 churches are told to repent. Therefore, if you will not watch, I will come upon you as a thief, and you will not know what hour I will come upon you. By the way, Jesus is coming, okay? Some of us are going to be ready, right? Some of us aren't. So he's warning this church is not ready for the return of Jesus. If I go ask 10 Christians out in the community right now, are you ready for the return of Jesus? 9 out of 10 of them are going to say, well, I know he's going to come back, but my kid has track meet next week, you know? Or, you know, I want to have this, and I want my son to go to college. And don't get me wrong, is it okay for us to have a 50-year plan? Absolutely, okay? But we live in the one-day plan, every day for Jesus. And, of course, we will have our big plans too. But with this church, Jesus says, if you aren't going to watch for me, I'm going to come upon you as a thief. And we'll talk about that again. Once again, that's pointing to the imminent return of Jesus. I said it funny there, didn't I? That was good. I've noticed a few other people say Jesus like I say Jesus. I really have.
I did the other day.
Yeah, I'm not the only one. Everybody, these guys all think I say Jesus funny. Okay.
Jesus.
Jesus. I guess I put emphasis on the us. I don't know.
You said so too.
I don't know. I think Brandon says it kind of like me.
Just rock it.
Yeah. I think you guys are just jealous that I can say Jesus so eloquently. Okay, you have a few names even in Sardis who have not defiled their garments, and they shall walk with me in white, for they are worthy. He who overcomes shall be clothed in white garments, and I will not blot out his name from the book of life. Ooh, that's going to be a deep study right there. What is the book of life? What does it mean to have your name erased out of the book of life? Lots of interesting stuff there. But I will confess his name before my Father and before his angels. He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. I'll give you guys a hint of what I believe about the Book of Life. Okay, a lot of people will read the Book of Life and they'll kind of think about it in a negative context. Okay, what I would argue is that this is actually an extremely positive context. And I'm not going to tell you what it means yet. Okay, we got to wait till we get there.
In about 6-8 months.
Yep. No, I'm telling you, I'm already through like the third thing on this. This church we're going to fly through, but it's really good. Really good material. Okay, the church at Sardis. Let's go ahead and really quick look at let's look at some of the fun background stuff here. So we see that little island of Patmos right there in the middle. By the way, these seven churches are in where we would call Turkey today. Okay, modern day Turkey, Asia Minor. You see that little island of Patmos right there in the middle? That was where John received this revelation from Jesus to these seven churches. Okay, now we saw the vision given, and then the first church was Ephesus. I see something here. Okay, I don't care if anybody else doesn't see it. Hunter sees it. He's a charismatic. Do you guys see? Well, first of all, you're going to notice that these seven churches, they go kind of in a clockwise way. Okay, you have Ephesus, Smyrna, Pergamum. By the way, those three churches all have very common similarities. They're all on the coast, and then we're finally moved over to Thyatira, Sardis, Philadelphia, Laodicea. Those four, we'll see, have commonalities too. They're bunched together. I see a seven. Do you guys see a seven?
Yes.
Tia, you don't like that, do you? Because I just see a seven. Okay? And I see it going in order. Yeah. And I was asking my mom this the other day, is numbers universal? So like, is a seven in English, if you saw a seven in China, is it still a seven?
No.
No?
I think it's a Western thing.
Okay. So that could be a stretch. You know, I'm a charismatic now, so I'm allowed to have fun. Okay? Charismatics party. So, anyways, where was I going with this? Do you know where I was going with this?
Well, you're telling them.
Oh, I know what I'm doing. I'm just kidding. So anyways, so we're all the way down here to
I don't know where he's going.
Yeah, I don't either. But I just wanted to show you guys that it's in kind of a clockwise order. And whether there's a seven there or not, it's just kind of interesting that as we get to Laodicea, we're kind of seeing it come to the end. I see something there. What are the chances that God would lay it out in a clockwise order? You know, what are the chances?
But God would also know in advance that you would see a seven. So when he did that, he was like, Chuck's going to see a seven.
See?
You already knew.
See? That's what I'm saying. My God is big, right? So Sardis here, you kind of see that it's right in the middle of parallel to Smyrna there. This was actually one of the biggest trading hubs of the ancient Middle East. This country is rich, okay? This country, the more I study their ancient history, this was like the Hollywood of the ancient world, okay? We'll see that as we move forward here. But as I already said, those first three on the coast, they had similarities. But these last four, they're kind of lumped together. And we've already talked about this, so I'm not going to spend a whole lot of time. Anybody who remembers that we lay these seven churches on the menorah, we see Ephesus, Smyrna, Pergamos, Thyatira right in the middle. It's the biggest, the longest, Sardis, Philadelphia, Laodicea. Many theologians point out the fact that the first three churches have a lot of similarities and some structural things that hold them together. We'll see that these last four have the same thing. These last four have some structural things that hold them all together, and we'll talk about that. In actuality, you guys see the menorah there. You guys see how you have the middle is Thyatira, and then what's interesting is you'll see that the two candles on both sides, okay, Pergamos and Sardis, those are kind of connected to the same, no, the middle is the shaft. We don't know what we're going to call these.
Branch.
What? Branch. Okay, so the branches are connected. What's interesting is when I get to the very end of this, I will show you guys crazy similarities between Pergamos and Sardis and how they're connected. Same thing with Smyrna and Philadelphia. You guys will see crazy similarities between Smyrna and Philadelphia. And finally, Ephesus and Laodicea. Me and Tihud were actually talking about this last night. We will see some crazy similarities between things that happen in Ephesus and things that happen in Laodicea. So, once again, just structural integrity that's crazy that only God can pull off. Bless you. So as I was saying, structurally, these last four churches, there's some theologians teach that all four of these have explicit references to Jesus' second coming, and also the promise to the overcomer. Each one of these seven letters has a promise to the overcomer. he who overcomes shall, and then Jesus tells them a promise. These promises are in the body of the letter. Okay, I know we'll talk more about that when we get to the promise. We talk about that kind of at every church. So let's look at some important background information in ancient history. Let me make sure I'm still recording here. Okay.
What's this guy?
I know. It's annoying me.
Bye-bye.
Okay. Do you think we should start the important background, or should we wait for this next week? Because I don't want to get in the middle of this important. It's 9:50.
We should probably wait. I think we're good.
Just wait. Do you guys have any questions about Sardis with the initial, anything? Anybody have any questions about Revelation 2 and 3, the church age, tribulation, anything? Open forum. We got 5 minutes. Let's party. I'm high on coffee right now, if you guys haven't noticed.
Are all those churches still in existence today, the exact same spot and everything? Or?
No. There are remnants of those. Okay, all the archaeological stuff, and I'll even show you pictures of those churches. But it is interesting that you asked that question, because some people believe that, you know how we're talking about the first three are grouped together and the last four are grouped together? Some people believe that these church ages, or these times in church history, that the first three are no longer in existence and they no longer can be in existence. For example, the Ephesus represents the apostolic age. Okay, so that was when Jesus was literally in direct correlation with the apostles and it was the birth of the church. That's never going to happen again. So that Ephesus is gone. Okay, Smyrna was a time of extreme persecution when the whole world, basically Rome, came against Christianity, tried to eradicate it completely. We see pockets of that today. You know, you go to Muslim countries and you'll see Christian persecution, but it's not on a worldwide scale yet. Okay, so some theologians will say we're never going to see that worldwide persecution again, where it's just you have to kill Christians in general.
Besides, not in this dispensation.
Right. But
see it in the trib, but not during this dispensation, not during the church age.
Right, and that's deep. Finally, Pergamos was when the church became the state church under Constantine. Okay, so for the first time ever, the world was literally Christian. Okay, under Constantine, the Roman world ruler at that time.
Physically, but not spiritually.
So imagine the United Nations today. Okay, so we have Secretary Ban Ki-moon. Imagine if Ban Ki-moon said, we now announce that the world is Christian. That's kind of what happened in this time, okay, of Pergamos church history. So those three are done. Those three churches are never in existence again. Now the last four, many theologians teach that that's when Jesus is going to come back on the earth, when these four churches that we're talking about are the most prevalent on earth. So Thyatira, Sardis, Philadelphia, and Laodicea. And of course, we all want to be Philadelphia, right? Philadelphia, the church of brotherly love. But those four churches are going to be the most prevalent on earth when Jesus comes back. That's why some theologians teach that the second coming is written in those last four letters. That makes sense?
And they came on the scene in that order too. It was Thyatira, then Sardis, then Philadelphia, then Laodicea.
Yeah, Chuck Misler always says, these seven churches, by the way, there were hundreds of churches, okay? Jesus could have wrote letters to 100 different churches, and he picked these seven, okay? Why did he pick these seven? Because we believe he was laying out church history in advance, so nerds like us could sit here today and say, hey, Jesus is coming back, it's the end of the world, okay?
And now after you learn about all of them and you see those last four, you can drive around town, you'll see different buildings, you'll be like, Sardis.
Right.
Oh, that's so Thyatira. You'll know the difference.
Right. Well, and what's interesting...
Okay,
he says that tongue-in-cheek. Okay, obviously we aren't looking at these letters to say, hey, we're better than everybody else, right? And, oh, the Roman Catholic Church is so Thyatira, which they are, okay? But I'm not saying that in a bad way. It's just... You look at these letters as kind of a mirror. And if you personally have any of this stuff in your theology, that's when you need to get rid of it, right? And that's when you need to clean yourself up. And as I studied these seven letters, I had a lot of paganism that I had to get rid of. You know, it's a mirror. So you guys have a lot of cleanup to do. Okay?
Got a whole table of
pagans.
Yeah,
we need to lay hands on this table over here. Any other questions before we end?
Just Pergamos.
Yeah. Yeah, they're. I would say more like Thyatira.
Yeah, that's.
They're in some.
They might have been given over.
Hunter's into some witchcraft stuff.
Yeah.
Just kidding. They're good guys.
Oh, you got Ephesus. Walk. You got a pocket of Ephesus right here.
Yeah. Yeah. Of course, we're Philadelphia. We love everybody, right? All right, any last questions? We good? All right, let's pray and get out of here. Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you just as we sit back and we study all these different things and see how you orchestrated your word. It's beautiful. We thank you for this dispensation that we currently live in, the age of grace. We thank you that it's just so simple that all we have to do is trust the completed work of your Son and that we get to be with you, God. We just pray that you would empower us in these last days to kind of see this world through the proper lens and be able to explain to people biblically what's going on. God, help us to get our circle of influence onto the ark. Help us to get our circle of influence in you and in your Son. We just pray that you would empower us and help us to live in these interesting days that we live in. God, prepare our hearts for whatever you would have today. Continue to speak to us and through us. In Jesus' name.
If you've enjoyed our presentations or felt led by the Lord, please feel free to donate at esfirst.org.